Lord, I thank you, Lord, for your tenderness, Lord, the way that you deal with us as your children. I just pray right now, Lord, that you would just begin, Holy Spirit, just to search us. Father, we come before you this morning with an open heart. We give you access, Lord, to every place of our hearts. Pray that we would not leave any stone unturned. Lord, any wound that you want to come and heal this morning, any hurt, any pain, we give that to you. But I'm believing that you're going to come and do some deep inner healing. Pray that fear would go in Jesus' name. That your love would cast out fear. Thank you for your word, Lord. And there would just be love encounters, just an embrace this morning. And each and every one of us could feel your embrace. So we love you, Father. We worship you. We're here for you. Jesus, we thank you that you're worthy to be praised. We exalt you. In Jesus' name. It's all for you.
Thank you.
Thank you. surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. Oh, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. Oh, see, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. Oh, surely goodness and mercy.
Chris, I just want us to sing, "You're a good, good Father."
Yes.
Let's just, if you will, let's just stand up all over this place and let's just tell the Father how good He is.
Thank you.
My goodness.
Yes.
And the reason why man needs to know that God is good,
yes, Father.
Yes.
That there is
yes.
a wicked father that has taken our voices from us. There is a wicked father that has come to tell us, do not bless him, and where is he in your trial and in your tribulation? And yet we have written in a 2,000-year-old book that says that God is with us.
Yes.
He will never leave us nor forsake us.
Yes.
And he is a very present help in the time of trouble.
Yes.
And I just want to encourage us as
yes.
a man in
yes.
the Lord that God is with me as I grow old, and God is with me as I grow older. But I'm here to tell you that no matter what you're going through this morning, I don't care whether it's good or bad, God will see you through it. That God is not moved by seasons. Man is moved by seasons. God doesn't have a winter. God doesn't have a summer. He doesn't have a fall. He doesn't have a spring. He's eternal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Seasons are what we go through. And I'm way into being an old man enough to know that we in our fallenness, we project our fallenness onto the living God. I'm here to say this morning that when Jesus prayed, Holy Father, and he said, Righteous Father, he was exonerating the Father in the midst of all mankind so that we as people of the earth would release God to be God for us.
Yes.
I make a strong appeal to our souls this morning, not to our spirit, because the spirit and God, they are one. Where the rivalry and where the tension and where the tug of war comes in is will, I say to my soul, you come in line
yes,
this morning
yes.
with the goodness of God. And whether I'm crippled or I'm lame or I'm halt or I'm blind, it is but within a twinkling of an eye when all of that gets done away with and everything, every crooked way is made straight. And every low place is made high, and every high place is made level wide, because the love of God will take care of everything in his time.
Yes, yes.
My encouragement as an old man, but long in the faith, and faithful in the faith because God has been faithful to me. I encourage us this morning that this thing that we call worship and this thing that we call singing, it is a God-given right.
Yes.
That God has said, into your spirit, man, I will awaken you. Into your spirit, man, I will give you praises. The scripture says that God creates the praises of our lips. And then the scripture says that he inhabits the praises of his people. He is here. You don't have to invoke his presence.
Amen.
Where two or more gathered in his name, there he is in the midst of them.
That's
and I encourage us strongly to hold on to the hem of his garment this morning, no matter what you're going through. And you do not let go of the hem of his garment.
Amen.
You make sure that you hold on to the hem of his garment so strong that he turns around and he says, who touched me?
Yes.
Who was that?
Yes.
Why won't they leave me alone? It's me, Lord. I'm desperate for you. Father, I recognize this morning that you've given us the great gift of words. And you've given us the great gift of having a mind and a heart that can come together to speak back to you. Because you're not a master and a dictator, and you want to whack us around and you want to whip us into shape. But you're the kind and marvelous and gracious Father who said, I want a dialogue with my kids. I want my kids to talk to me. I want my kids to tell me. I want my kids to be with me. I want my kids to long to just speak their hearts to me. And so, Father, I just pray, Lord, if there's the ability to impart at all.
Yes.
I pray, Lord, for a holy impartation. Father, we would take up the pages and the books that are our lives. And we would say to you, Lord, we offer them to you. And when the pages and the books of our lives, they are put away and they are done away with, that all of your will for us would have been fulfilled. Father, I pray for your fulfilled will
yes.
into the lives of your little kids. And Father, you don't call us by our military name, and you don't call us, Father, by our legal name. My name is Joe, but you call me Joey. My brother's name is Ted, but you call him Teddy. My brother's name is Chris, but you call him little Chris. My brother's name is Thomas. holy name.
I have a good God. Just make sure you're checking what you want to give to, if you want to give it to missions, anything like that. Make us aware of that. Give me just 1 second to go on that. We want to keep the nickels in our prayers. Shane got married yesterday. We're excited for her. Josiah and Jen, their wedding day is coming up. So.
Woo!
We are our first wedding here at the church.
Come on.
Let's pray. Father, we just thank you, Lord, just for the opportunity to worship you with the giving of our tithes and offerings. Lord, I pray for every need that's here, Lord. Just thank you, Lord, for the hope that's in you, Lord. I just pray for job opportunities, yes. Lord. Whatever the need is, Lord, I pray for you. Lord, intervene, Lord, work on behalf. Thank you for that. I pray for the needs of this house, Lord. Just pray that we continue to meet every need in Jesus' name, I pray.
I just sense that there are so many people that are really hungry
just for genuine, transparent relationships. So that's something that we want to be about. We talked about the power of testimony. And then this morning, I want to talk about becoming a house of prayer. And Jesus said, my house will be a house of prayer for all nations. And unfortunately, it's just not something that we place a lot of emphasis in the church, is prayer. I believe that prayer is the most important thing that we do during the week here. One man said, if you want to know how popular a church is, check out the Sunday morning service. If you want to know how popular the preacher is, check out the midweek service. But if you want to know how popular God is, go to the prayer meeting. So I'll let the Holy Spirit do what He wants to do in your heart, but there needs to be a desire in our heart, and I want to say from behind the pulpit, there's a real desire in my heart for more of us to show up to the prayer meetings that we have going on at the church. There's no reason why many of us should be showing up at 10:15 or 10:30 when there's prayer that's available at 9:15. Even if you're tired, we've got plenty of coffee and donuts, so I'm sure I can shake you, or the coffee will shake you or something. But just throwing it out there, we've got prayer at 9:15 in Classroom 1 every Sunday morning. Mama Marie does the prayer class, and they're just getting together and praying for the needs of the church in Lakeland. We've got prayer Thursday mornings here at the building from 11 to 12, and then from 6:30 to 7. There's tons of different ways to pray. And I want to talk to us tonight, or this morning, get confused, this morning about prayer. And as I was really praying, it's one of those things where I had a message on my heart, and I really wanted to go after the spirit of intercession and stir up a lot of different things. And as I sat down, as often happens to me, the Holy Spirit just kind of began to lay out a path for me that I just dared to walk down. And I just felt like He was talking to me so much about praying without a revelation of the fatherhood of God. That it is possible to have a prayer life without an understanding of whom we're praying to that would greatly affect our prayer life. So we named the church Heart of the Father Ministry for a very important reason. And I really believe that as I pray, if you're here this morning, you're here for a reason, because I believe God wants to deal with father wounds this morning as it relates to prayer. So I want you to bear with me, and I'm just going to open us up in prayer, and we are going to get started. And the title of this morning's message is going to be called Our Father. Father, we just come before You with open hearts, that no stone would be unturned. Lord, even now as we begin to resist what Your Spirit wants to do, Lord, we come against that right now, Lord, that Your perfect love is going to come and cast out fear, Lord. Lord, there are some here this morning that have been wounded, Lord, and they know if they stay wounded, people will feel sorry for them and pity them. Lord, but if we get healing, relationships around us have to change. But we have to be seen in a different light. Lord, we ask, Lord, that You would draw us from the shallows and the shadows into Your deep, deep river of life. Any area of our life that's not under hope is under a lie. Lord, would You expose the lies this morning that we're living under, that we've bought into, that have been projected on us? I pray for hope to fill every crevice of our heart. Yes. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 We all have a story about our earthly father. We all have a story about how our fathers treated us. Maybe how they didn't treat us. And I wanted to open up this morning with the story of a man that tells what it was like growing up in his house. When I was 13, my father abandoned me. My parents were in the middle of an ugly divorce, and I had been visiting my father in Tampa, Florida. As he was driving me home to Atlantic City, New Jersey, where I lived with my mother and five sisters, I, like a typical know-it-all teenager, kept arguing with him, heatedly defending my mother. We were nearing Baltimore, Maryland, when the argument became very intense. Suddenly, he stopped the car and said, "Get out." I thought he wanted me to see if we had a flat tire, so I walked around the car to check out the problem. When I got to his window, he rolled it down and I leaned toward him so he could tell me what he thought was wrong with the car. With rage on his face, he looked at me and said, "You are no good. You have never been any good. You will never be any good." He rolled up the window and drove away, leaving me standing by the side of the road more than 100 miles from home with less than a dollar in my pocket. Stunned by what had just happened, I stood in the street for the longest time, feeling absolutely abandoned, trying to figure out what I was going to do. My sense of what it meant to be a Mumford was severely shaken, but my street kid survival skills kicked in, and I hitchhiked home, suddenly trying to let the drivers know I had not eaten. After 15 hours, one very hungry boy finally made it to Atlantic City. This experience left deep impressions in my person. When I arrived home, something deep and unexplainable had changed in me. I felt like an entirely different person. In order to deal with the sense of rejection, shame, failure, and loss, I chose anger and superiority as a cover-up. Like many young people, I remember making a childhood vow to never ever trust another person as long as I live. The following year, I dropped out of school, taking menial employment in order to support my mom and five sisters in my father's absence. I finished my GED in the Navy, graduated from college, and earned my Master's of Divinity degree. But after several days of successful ministry, the consequences of my father's rejection was very much alive. Eventually, I was forced to recognize that I had deep internal anger directed at no one in particular. Eventually, I was forced to recognize that a deep internal anger directed at no one in particular, accompanied by fear, more accurately described as free-floating anxiety, both without any obvious source or cause. The fear and anger revealed themselves in a critical mouth and false superiority. These problems were very real, and I knew they were displeasing to God, yet I was unable to get free from them. Reading more Bible verses or ministering to more people certainly did not deal with the issues. Did you guys catch that? This guy's a minister, a master's in divinity, stands before people every day, talks about God, but there's still deep internal wounds. I call it spiritualizing. I knew anger, fear, and a critical mouth were not normal with these problems. They always became a present barrier to intimacy with God, for which my heart longed for. Like many who had preceded me in this search, I felt bound in heart and conscience to find answers to these problems, both for me personally and for others. Last paragraph. Because we must live in a less than perfect world, human failure, mistakes, and injuries like my dad's rejection of me take their toll on us, often appearing and reappearing many years later. Failure, disappointment, or betrayal from any loved one is always difficult to manage. However, if God can restore me, He can restore you. It's not magic. What I have to say is not experience-oriented. It is a journey. These lessons have come at a great personal expense, so have one on me. Allow me, by means of the illustrations and diagrams in this book, to take you toward God's land of promise. This book is called Agape Road, written by Bob Mumford. We're going to do home groups in the coming months, and what we're going to do is we're going to go through this book. But I wanted to use him as an example to say, whether they're acknowledged or unacknowledged, we all have some father wounds. My dad always said that people either deify their father or demonize their father. I've grown up with some of my issues, and I've talked with other people, and then for the first time in my life, I ran into people that thought that they had the greatest father on the earth. In fact, they thought that they had the greatest father so much that now their earthly father was better than the heavenly father. It was almost like an opposite end of the pendulum. So nothing's wrong with my dad. It's almost like they just thought that there was so much of something inside of him that they just couldn't understand the difference between God as father and their own father. Jesus said in John 14, 18, I will not leave you as orphans. You see that on the bus, Alan. I will not leave you as orphans. I want you to translate to me Jesus saying, I will not leave your orphan wounds and behavior unattended to. I want to deal with you tenderly. I will provide a way through the cross and through who I am to have a relationship with the Father. He will heal you. So there's something going off inside of us, because here's the deal. We have an earthly father, and however that father was, however he treated us, we're going to project that onto the heavenly father. So if your father, for example, was angry, nothing was ever good enough, when you accept a relationship with Christ, you're going to project that more times than not onto the heavenly father. So now you believe that nothing's ever good enough for him, and he's never proud of you. Has anyone ever recognized that? Because once you begin to recognize that, that's really the first step. But a lot of us, the light bulb still has to click on and say, wow, I'm doing that. Wow, I didn't recognize that all these wounds that I have had in the past, they're affecting my relationship. I talk to people all the time where their father abandoned them. They get to a point in spiritual growth where they never move forward because they're waiting for God to abandon them. So there's all sorts of things represented here. And I just want to read some scriptures. Romans 8. Romans chapter 8, verse 15. It's good if you bring your Bible to church or your iPhone or whatever. Romans 8, 15. For you did not receive a spirit that makes you a slave again to fear, but you received the spirit of sonship. By him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Galatians 4, 6 and 7. Galatians 4, 6 and 7. Because you are sons, God sent the Spirit of His Son into your heart. The Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father, so you are no longer a slave, but a son. And since you are a son, God has also made you an heir. An heir. I've heard people throw around, yeah, God is Father. We get that, right? I don't know, this is not something new. We talk about Father and God is Father, but do we really know it experientially? Is this just some thing where we get this mental ascent going and God is Father, we pray Father, but we don't really, our actions don't dictate like we have a true Father. By Him we cry out, Abba, Father. The name of this ministry is Heart of the Father Ministry. I want to tell you, I believe that you can be a Christian your whole life and have a relationship with Jesus that is outside the umbrella of the fatherhood of God. I'm telling you, has anybody ever heard of Derek Prince? One of the greatest Bible teachers of all time. At the end of Derek Prince's days, he began to have a true revelation of the fatherhood of God. And he said this, after teaching the Bible for 63 years, I never once taught on the fatherhood of God. You ready what he said? Oh my God, what have I done? So See, because when the Father is present in our lives, in a real and a powerful way, and I want to tell you a promise of the Father, is that before He begins to reveal Himself as Father, He wants to heal our existing father wounds. You'll never know the true Father unless you work through your personal father wounds. But we've either got to acknowledge that we do have them, or that we're working through them, or that we've been healed by them. There's various different spiritual levels in this place. But I want to tell you, I'm going to ask Josiah, if you'll come on. You'll stand over there, Jason, when you come on. You stand over there. And we get it. It says, He sent the Spirit in through the Son, and we cry out. Can you guys say it? Abba Father. I always saw Abba Father as being directly connected. Okay? One day while I was studying, this is what the Father said to me. He said, Jeremiah, I want you to learn how to live and pray in between Abba and Father. We don't leave here without seeing that there is a gap in between Abba and Father. Jason, go that way. Go to the wall. That's good. Okay. The point of our conversion, when was it for you? You were planted, the Spirit of the Son came into your heart, and you've been planted in between the realm of Abba and Father. Every other reality outside of that is orphanhood. We as believers, as sons and daughters being welcomed into the family of God, there's nothing else outside of Abba and Father. We live within that revelation. Let that sink in, please. Sean, will you come up? Will you stand, my Father? Paul, come up and stand, my Father. When we become planted in between Abba and Father, remember, I used to always think Abba, Father. And then the Father said to me, I want to teach you how to learn and pray and live in between the realm of Abba and Father. He began to talk to me about Abba. It's a term of endearment. It's a term that speaks of innocence. I believe that a lot of us, we were inflicted with wounds during our childhood of rejection and abandonment and physical and sexual abuse. And some of us this morning, God wants to reveal Himself as Abba. He wants to heal those wounds as a child and that received, and Paul represents a young person. And then as we grow up in maturity, as full blossoming sons and daughters, we begin to learn how to call God Father, which speaks of maturity, as Sean is. But the roles can be reversed. Now, Sean, you go this way, and Paul, you come this way. Look at them chronologically. Now, I know Sean's a young man.
Thank you.
But if we do not allow the Father to heal our existing father wounds, especially as young people, we can be 40, 50, 60, 70 years old and still need healing from when we were young people. But you could have a young man who submitted to the healing process at 16, 17, 18, already know God truly as Father because he submitted to that healing process. But I want to help us to understand, this is a revelation of the Father's heart. When we say Father, when we come before the Father and pray, Father, know that we are forever living in between Abba and Father. Everything else outside of that is orphanhood. Jesus in John 14, 18 said, I will not leave you as orphans, saying, you are one. And I want to come and I want to heal you. Thank you guys. You guys can be seated. There's a quote by Brennan Manning that's absolutely just undone me. And this is what Brennan Manning says. He says, we must define ourselves as radically beloved by the Father. Any other identity is an illusion. We must radically define ourselves as radically beloved by the Father. Any other identity is an illusion.
Excellent.
See, I can see here in the Spirit parts of the doors of our hearts are starting to swing open. We want to begin that process today. Or maybe you tried to work on something years ago and you shut that door. See, because your destiny lies right here. Healing of existing earthly wounds. It launches us fully into what God has for us. But we've got to deal with this stuff. We've got to trust Him. That the Father is not like any father that was ever created because they were sinful. I love the worship, what we're singing about. He's a good, good God. He's a loving Father. The goodness of God has changed my life. I grew up in an atmosphere in sports where people are up yelling in your face. Nothing was ever good enough. You had to be an excellent athlete to win a championship. And you know what I did? I projected my sports environment onto God. I could just not believe that God was proud of me. I just could not believe that anything was good enough. Jesus, the Lord began to take me through the scriptures. And we all know it. The voice came down from heaven and said, this is my Son, whom I love. In Him I'm well pleased. You know what my favorite thing about that scripture was? Jesus hadn't performed any miracles. So the love and the acceptance and the affirmation from the Father wasn't dependent upon His performance.
Right.
Performance-oriented Christianity plagues so many of us.
Right.
We feel like we have to do this to get right with the Lord, and He'll love us if we do this. And I prophesied this morning during worship about Hosea, that the Father would pursue a people that were not pursuing Him. What would Lakeland look like trembling under the weight of words of hope and promise? What would the Church of America look like if someone braved the fear of standing up and prophesying about a good, good God and a happy Father? Have you ever tried it? It's like, I know most of us are going to go religious and start condemning. You just walked up to someone that's broken and that's hurting. Just talking to them about a good, good God and a happy Father. Watching them just fall on the ground and cry and God heal them. Sounds like Jesus to me.
Amen.
Whether it was the woman caught in adultery or the woman at the well.
When I
began to get this revelation of Father, let the Lord heal me. It lifted off that burden. And I ask it all the time, why are all the Christians so depressed? Why are we so miserable? Where's the joy? Where's the light? If we can begin to enjoy the Father as much as He's enjoying us. I don't think I could ever, I really didn't know how to worship because I was convinced that God was constantly obsessed with my sin. All through high school, it was like began to give me a revelation about the blood of Jesus and about what true repentance was all about. I just began to walk like I was as light as a feather. And I believe that there's going to be a revelation of the fatherhood of God that's being released in the earth right now. That's drawing many, many people in. We have to define ourselves as radically beloved by God. Many of you know I love Charles Spurgeon. I love his stories. And where I want to turn the corner is we're talking about the heart of the Father. And today we're talking about becoming a house of prayer. And something that the Lord came and said to me again is this: you can spend your whole life praying without ever acknowledging me as Father. The title of this morning's message is called Our Father. So the Lord wants to heal us, but I want us to know that knowing God as Father changes our prayer life. And Charles Spurgeon, there was five college students that were spending a Sunday in London, so they wanted to hear the famous preacher C.H. Spurgeon. So while they waited for the doors to open, the students were greeted by a man that asked them, "Gentlemen, let me show you around. Would you like to see the heating plant of this church?" The students were reluctant because it was a July day and it was very hot outside, but they consented. They walked down a stairway with the man under the sanctuary, and he quietly whispered, "Here is our heating plant." And he opened the door. Before the students were 700 people lying prostrate in prayer, asking the Father to bless the service that was about to take place. Softly closing the door, the man introduced himself as Charles Spurgeon. Where's the heating plant of this church? Where's the heating plant of your life? Where are the times or the days that you're down on your knees asking God to bless what you're about to do instead of doing something and then asking God for His blessing? There was a businessman that came to me. He had just opened up a business, spent $40,000, $50,000, and he said, "Do you think God will bless my business?" I said, "Well, did you ask Him before you did it?" You know what he said to me? "Why would I do that?" I didn't answer his question. I think he knew what I was about to say. Well, it was 3 months later when the thing shut down. How many things do we do in our life without really asking, soaking those decisions in prayer? I want to become a church. I want to go from liking prayer to being a praying church. Turn to Matthew 6, and I'll land the plane this morning. Good old Jesus had to stir up some trouble in his day. It's helpful to understand that in the entire Old Testament, the word Father is used 6 times. And the only time that the word Father is used, it's always in reference to Him being a Father to the nation. The word Father in the whole entire Old Testament never had personal application. In fact, when the rabbis wrote about Father, they wrote the word A-B-B-I, Abai. Every time that you see Jesus write about the Father in the New Testament, the Gospels, He says the word A-B-B-A, Abba. You have to understand that we just throw around Father, all this stuff. When Jesus talked to the people and the religious leaders about God as Father, it was scandalous. It was revolutionary. It was something that totally blew every gasket that they had inside of them. There are points throughout the gospel where they literally wanted to kill Him, because He was talking about God as Father like they had never known before. I believe that there's fresh and there's a new revelation of the Father where men and women are going to begin to stand up in the church in the last days and talk about God as Father in such deep and close ways that people are going to recognize, I don't even know who you're talking about. So if you see in Matthew 6, verse 5, we preached through this before, Jesus says, and when you pray, part of the Sermon on the Mount here, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by men. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think that they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what needs to be asked of him. Verse 9. This then is how you should pray. Our Father. I can't even go on from there. It's one of the most quoted, Our Father in heaven. I've just been undone by our Father. The word Father is used 17 times in the Sermon on the Mount, and 15 of them is translated your Father. I'm telling you, the primary reason why Jesus came to the earth was to reveal the Father to us. This is so close to my heart. And again, I'm not talking about earthly stuff. I'm talking about truly walking in relationship with the Father of lights in whom there is no variation of shadow. He is consistent. We must know this God. Sometimes I'm tired of just calling him God. Who is he to you? I met with a young man this week that's come to the church a few times and started asking him. I had just made the mistake of assuming that he knew the Lord. And I said, well, tell me about your history with God. He began to mumble and just kind of said, I grew up in church. But I said, well, what do you know about God? And he said, to tell you the truth, nothing. I just sat in the back chair my whole life, and I mean, I know how to say the prayers, but just a very transparent moment, but I don't really know this God. My dad left, and, you know, I started asking him, so how did that make you feel to play football? He was never in the stands. All the probing questions of how did it feel? For years, he's been in total denial. Oh, I was fine. He loved me. He sent me to college. We try to protect those that we love, even those that we don't love. We try to make it out to be, it really wasn't that bad. Oh, I knew somebody where their dad was worse than my dad, so it really wasn't that bad. We justify. We do all these different things. And Jesus came and he starts talking to them about our Father. I'd like to pass out this chart, if you'd be so kind to pass this around. And as we're passing those around, I just want to remind you again about how important this is. Derek Prince preached the Word of God for 63 years. And at the end of his days, he says he finally caught hold of the revelation of the fatherhood of God. And he began to realize that he had taught and preached through the scriptures without this revelation. And he said during his dying days, oh my God, what have I done? We're talking about prayer in our Father rooms. I didn't get this anywhere. The Father just spoke this to me. And I want to close with this. This is called Our Father Prayer Chart. Give me just 1 second to pass them along. If you're a married couple, just kind of take one. There's probably not enough for everybody. But why we pray. Sons and daughters see prayer as a way to connect to and with the Father. Intimacy is the chief concern. Orphans approach prayer as a way to get needs met. They pray because we want something. How we pray. Sons and daughters ask the Father, knowing that it brings joy and delight to hear our requests. Orphans beg the Father, believe that we are bothering Him and He has no time for us. I just want to stop right there. I believe that you can tell a lot about a person's relationship with Christ according to how they pray and the content of what they're praying. Sons and daughters ask of the Father. Orphans beg. I have been in more prayer meetings where people have begged and demanded and cried out, and I wanted to say, do you know who you're talking to? The way that we pray at times is simply appalling. We give God a grocery list. I got a quote by Leonard Ravenhill, which is one of my all-time favorites. It just simply said, we spend more time making demands on God than we actually do asking of Him. I want to challenge you. When you come together and we pray, our Father, Father, do we begin to beg Him like beggars? Or do we understand what it means to pray in a bridal paradigm? Do you know that Jesus is making intercession upon your behalf? When I caught hold of that, I thought to myself, okay, so instead of crying out and acting like a crazy person, and I'm like treating this guy called Father like he's my bro, I'm gonna listen. Jesus, could you help me to know what you're praying upon this person that's on my heart? Wait for a while. Okay. Jesus, I'm going to partner with you because I believe you spoke to me, and then I'm just going to partner with you. Rather than, we're not listening at all. Maybe this is the prophetic side of me where I feel like we have to listen before we like just go into heavy intercession. Because sometimes I'm like, we start interceding and we're totally off what Jesus is praying. He's probably not going to answer and hear prayers that He's not praying. Sons and daughters, how do we approach the Father versus we're demanding and we're like beggars? There are enough beggar intercessors in the body of Christ. We need to learn how to pray as sons and daughters, knowing that the Father hears us. It's this whole thing of understanding that we're not bothering Him. If you walked up to your dad and he was putting his hands in his ears like this, and you thought he was ignoring you, wouldn't you scream and yell really loud so you could grab hold of his attention? Would it be any different if you knew that he was all ears? That you weren't bothering him, that he had all the time in the world? Yeah. I think that might change how we pray. The next time that you pray, just observe yourself. Posture to prayer. Sons and daughters ask according to the Thy will be done principle. Understands that the Father knows best. You can underline that when prayers are left unanswered. Orphans demand according to My will be done. Grow angry when we do not get our way. The orphan rears its head so strongly when we pray and the prayers are not answered. When you're praying for something and believing for something and it's not happening, let me give you a word of advice. That's a great time to take a knee and bow before the Father and say, Father, even though I don't understand, You know best.
That's right.
other than being demanding and growing angry and tired and frustrated over why they're not being heard. Orphans believe the Father answers prayer according to our behavior. We credit our performance as to why our prayers are answered. Has anyone ever prayed something and your lifestyle began to falter and the Father still answered your prayers? And it was like the best slap in the face ever. Father, thank you so much for your grace and your mercy. Man, I don't want to get into that lifestyle. He only answers my prayers when my performance dictates how I'm doing. Focus of prayer, we'll close. Sons and daughters, when they pray, it's Jesus-centered. Focuses on magnification. Consistently confesses what Christ has already done on the cross. Exalts what Christ is currently doing. Orphans, the focus of their prayer is man-centered. Focuses on what the enemy is constantly doing. Constantly targets areas where Christ is not currently doing what we want him to do. It's just from the Holy Spirit. You can take that home. You can put it on your fridge. So two things this morning. Believe that the Lord wants to heal some wounds this morning that have been inflicted by our earthly fathers. Now some of us, we're at different stages. Some of us are going to be willing to admit that, yeah, I've definitely got some wounds. I've got some pains. Others of us are still in denial, and I'm just going to pray that the Lord will just speak to you. And in your own time and in His timing, He'll work. And I'm also going to pray that the Father would teach us how to pray as sons and daughters. That if the vision of this church is to become a house of prayer, when we gather for corporate prayer meetings, when we listen to one another pray, I want us to, you know, that's a son or daughter that's praying. They're not praying like an orphan. Chris, will you come up? You guys just stand with me this morning. I think it was so prophetic just for them to sing, He's a good, good God and a happy Father. Just think it was confirmation of what He wants to do. Someone in this room has migraines, you even have neck pain at times. You're a woman, and I believe it's a direct result of all the foul language and the curses that your father spoke over you as a young girl. Wanted to be someone for you that he never could be. Father wants to come and let you know that he's very present, that he's never leaving. I see a birthday party that a father missed. 16 years old, 18 years old. He put up such a strong guard. Father wants to walk you through forgiveness. There's a man in here that was abused by your father. I just see just this presence of anger that still resides inside of you. You're growing in the Lord and you're growing so beautifully. The Father just is so proud of you. But there's a greater releasing of the anger inside. That's you. I just want you to just say to the Father, release my anger to you. It's almost like a dizziness or confusion inside of some minds in here that there was so much turmoil, so much devastation, so much destruction in your parents' relationship as a child. You're just dazed. It's almost like you're numb. There's confusion. There's chaos. The Father welcomes you to a life in Him of stability. To learn how to live between Abba and Father. No more yelling. Father, I pray for the abused this morning. Lord, those that have been physically and sexually abused, whether it's a secret, Lord, or it's known by some or by many, we're asking that you come and bring healing this morning. Come and touch the deep places. Come and deal with fear. Come and deal with anger, even rage. Chris, I just want you to sing it. If you're here this morning and you just want prayer, just acknowledging you need healing, that you want to learn how to pray as a son or a daughter. I just want to invite you to the front. We're going to pray for you. Thank you guys for coming this morning. We'd love to see you tomorrow. But it's good that the Lord just wants to bring you. I'm in love. morning's feet.